everybody, this is Christopher with AG Productions, and welcome to another review video. Today we're going to be having a look at the second issue of Hammer and Bolter magazine, talking about several of the short stories in said magazine. So let's jump right in, shall we? This particular magazine contains three different short stories, an interview with author James Swallow, and chapter three of the Soul Drinker's novel, Phalanx. Now, as I did with the previous issue of Hammer and Bolter, I skipped the Phalanx chapter because I have the book itself, and if I'm going to read the book, I'd like to read it all at one time instead of one chapter here, one chapter there, that kind of thing. So, what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be talking about The Dark Path by Gav Thorpe, Exhumed by Steve Park, and the final short story, The Rat Catcher's Tale by Richard Ford. Let's start things off with The Dark Path by Gav Thorpe. Now, this was it could have been a very, very good story. It could have been a good read, let's put it that way. The problem with this particular short story is in the way that it's written. It is written in a very strange style where you're not told the story in order. The story is told out of order, beginning with the end of the story, and then there's a flash back to the beginning of the story, and then there's a flash forward to about the middle of the story, and a flash back to somewhere slightly after the beginning of the story, and then another flash forward to slightly after the middle of the story. And it continues bouncing forth, back and forth between the beginning of the story and the middle of the story until finally the beginning of the story catches up to the beginning part of the middle of the story, and the middle of the story catches up to the end of the story. It's a really, really, really poor way to write a book. The only way I can think of to describe it, and I thought I would give you guys an example, is suppose for a moment that you are watching Star Wars. And Star Wars, let's say episode 4, because that's what I think of when I refer to as Star Wars. Star Wars starts out with the run against the Death Star. So that all the X-Wings are flying down into the trench. And that's where the movie starts. And as they're flying into the trench, you've got all the TIE fighters coming in after them. And about midway through that scene, it cuts. And the next scene that you see is Princess Leia on the battle barge being captured by Darth Vader way back at the very beginning of the movie. And then, it might run through Luke leaving Tatooine. And then before you get into the Alderaan system, it jumps back to the Death Star battle. And you get more TIE fighters coming in, and they're doing more Death Star stuff. And then, let's say by the time Vader makes his decision to get in his custom TIE and go out and fight, right about then it cuts back to the scene where they're all flying into Alderaan, and they find that Alderaan has been destroyed. And, the movie keeps going for 15, 20 more minutes, and then it cuts back to the Death Star. And finally, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, you go. And the final scene of the movie is them deciding that they should attack the Death Star. And that's where the movie ends. That's how this book is written, or this short story is written. It is really, really bizarre. Not saying the story is bad. I'm just saying the writing style in this particular instance was very, very poor, and I would not recommend reading this one. Now, the second story that we're going to talk about is Exhumed by Steve Park. This is a novel out of the 40K universe, all right? By the way, The Dark Path was a novel out of the Warhammer universe featuring various high elves and what could very soon be dark elves. But Exhumed is a very interesting story about a group of space marines that are going to this particular planet to find an old Eldar relic. And what they find is that this relic that the Eldars have created is actually a prison cell for a gigantic, monstrous Xenos creature, probably Tyranid in its origin. And the reason the Eldar have left it there, being the intelligent Eldar that they are, is they could not figure out a way to destroy it, and Space Marines, being the brutish, hulking, you know, shoot first, think later, had decided that, hey, this is an Eldar thing, it needs to be destroyed no matter what. And so they crack this thing open, not intentionally, but they excavate it, and through excavation it gets cracked, and the creature inside becomes released, and this squad of Space Marines goes to fight this thing. Now, what I found kind of odd about this story is that the squad of Space Marines is not a single chapter of Marines, and I have never heard of this particular... I've never heard of this particular concept before in the 40K universe, where you'll have, let's say, a 5 or 6 man team, and each one of them belongs to a different Space Marine chapter. I think that's it's something I've never heard of before. I don't know if it's a concept created just for the story or if it's an actual concept in the 40K universe. I think it's a little odd, though, myself, you know, but that's just me. This was an okay story, and truthfully, it could have been really, really, really well done, except for the fact that it ended very poorly. The idea, and spoiler alert, by the way, so skip ahead a couple minutes if you don't want to hear this. The idea was that this gigantic, monstrous thing that they compared to like a Moloch or a Trigon, but much, 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 much larger in its size, was covered in impenetrable armor, all right? And because of this impenetrable armor, they were unable to do anything. And unfortunately, it ends in the way every story ends, where something has impenetrable armor. And that is, somebody gets the bright idea that they need to get eaten and kill this thing from the inside. And that's exactly what they do. And so, like I said, it was an okay story, but it lacked originality in the conclusion of the story. That has been done so many times, where some gigantic creature is, you know, terrorizing a planet or a town or whatever, and the hero gets the idea that the only way to kill it is from the inside out. So he gets swallowed and cuts his way through and ends up killing the creature from the inside. And for me, it just seemed like kind of a cop-out. There wasn't really... It almost seemed just like maybe somebody had seen that in a movie somewhere or read it in another story and thought, that would work really well in the 40K universe. We could create this really big, monstrous Tyranid creature and wrap a story around it and then sell it to people. And maybe they haven't seen that concept happen ever before. And so it'll be surprising to them when the guy gets eaten. But, I mean, to be honest with you, you could see it coming a mile away. It was, so unbelievably obvious. And so it was kind of a rough story to get through, truthfully. I'm just being honest with you. But that was Exhumed. Okay story. At least it was readable. At least it was written from front to back, start to finish. Anyway. Let's move on to the third story. The third story was The Rat Catcher's Tale, obviously a story out of the Warhammer universe. And I have to admit, this one was relatively enjoyable. The characters of this story were memorable. I don't want to say likable, but certainly a couple of the characters were... they had enough personality to where you could kind of get behind the character. Even in a short story that this was, you kind of learn enough about their background and their personality and the way they act and the way they think to develop a little bit of a liking for the character. And that's always nice, to be able to enjoy the characters that you're reading about. But it's a story about a man named Hugo that lives in this really big mansion, and he can't sleep. Every time he goes to sleep, he hears rats scurrying around all the time. And so he goes through various efforts to alleviate his rat problem. And in the end, he hires this former rat catcher of, I believe it was Talapheim, was the city that they were in. And when I say rat catcher, this is one of the guys that would go down into the sewers and, you know, kill the rats and then kill the Skaven as well down there. And so this guy says that he can take care of his problem, and he goes to his house and does all manner of fun things to this guy's house, just shy of blowing it up entirely. And very obviously, towards the end of the book, we find out that this man does not just have a rat problem, he has a full-blown Skaven problem. But the story is very, very well written. The only thing I didn't like was the very end of the story. It was... Okay, I'll give you the spoiler alert here. Okay, so if you don't want to hear the spoiler, click off or fast forward or something. Basically, the end of the story was they found out this guy's house was built on top of a giant warpstone cave. And that these Skaven and these rats were tunneling under this guy's house trying to harvest all this stuff. And that was all the clicking and scurrying that he heard all night long, were these rats moving around underneath his home. And so this rat catcher, after he gets rid of all the vermin, tells the guy, you know, if you get rid of all this warpstone that's underneath your house and build a nice, strong, solid foundation with newer warpstone, the rats are not going to come back. But if you leave the warpstone there, they're going to come back and you're going to have the same problem all over again. So the guy gets rid of all the warpstone. And the end of the story, he's sleeping in his bed and he's having nightmares again. And he wakes up and he looks down at the foot of his bed. And at the foot of his bed, he has a small statue carved out of warpstone, and he's sort of had a statue made to commemorate and remember this event in his life. And his thoughts are, you know, what could a small little amount of warpstone do? And at that point, that's where the story stops being pretty darn cool and takes a really strange turn, because in the last couple of sentences we find out that this guy, he looks down at the floor and he sees a tail like flopping along between his legs, like on the floor. And in my mind, I'm thinking, you know, he's got a Skaven standing behind him, but in actuality, what has happened is he is turning into a rat. And to me, it seems kind of a strange ending. I think it would have been more interesting if we had seen that that one little teeny tiny piece of warpstone had brought more Skaven back to his house, just for that one little piece, just to kind of show him a lesson of, yes, even one tiny little piece really does make a big difference with these rat people. And I think it would have made a better ending than him turning into a rat. But I kind of understand the idea that the warpstone, him living on top of it for so many years, had altered his mind and was now altering his body. So it's not a horrible ending, but I don't think it was the best ending for the book. But anyway, just my take on the whole thing. Anyway, that's about it for Hammer and Bolter issue number 2. So as far as an overall score for this particular issue of Hammer and Bolter, because of the really odd nature of some of the stories, I'm going to give this one maybe a 5.5 out of 10. It's not great, but it's still worth reading, especially if you like the Warhammer and the 40K universe, and you like hearing stories out of them. They're interesting reads. You might have to slog through a couple of them just to get to the good parts, so to speak. But I wouldn't say I recommended it, But if you're one of those people that, you know, you want to read everything from the 40K universe, obviously pick it up and just kind of be wary of some of the strangeness that abounds in issue number 2 of Hammer and Bolter. If you don't have to read everything from the Warhammer or the 40K universe, I'd recommend picking up at least the Ratcatcher's Tale if you can find it by itself. It's worth a read. That would probably be the only one of the three that I would recommend fully out of this issue of Hammer and Bolter. But you know, for $3.99, it's not a bad deal picking up all three of them and just go ahead and read them anyway. Anyway, that's all I got for you guys today. So I hope that you've enjoyed this review of Hammer and Bolter magazine issue number 2. More of these on the horizon coming up soon. Please leave any comments down in the comments section down below, or if you have any questions, you're welcome to leave those there as well. Also, be sure to leave a thumbs up on this video and subscribe to AG Productions if you have not already done so. Again, I really do appreciate you guys watching. Thank you very much. God bless you all. Have a wonderful day, and I will see you all in the next video.